And welcome to our tour about Google Summer of Code. We participated as Freifunk at the Google Summer of Code, and we had this year about 15 students and 15 projects. And three of our students are here today to show their projects to us. Maybe a few words to Google Summer of Code. It's a program driven by Google to support open source organizations, as for example, like Freifunk. We as Freifunk act as an umbrella organization for a lot of other wireless network communities, for example, Ninux.org from Italy, where Gabriel is from, and we have Arne. He does a lot of OpenWRT or lead development, and Paul had a project with Altamundi, I guess. Was it Giphy? LibreMesh, okay. We already had a talk about LibreMesh at this stage too, so Paul developed his project for LibreMesh and will present them as next person. At first, we have Gabriel from Linux.org to show his project.
Can you hear me? Is it working?
Yeah. Now you're here. Okay. So
thank you. Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Gabriele Gemmi, and I'm a Linux activist. And I did this project in two Google Summer of Code. This is the second and, unfortunately, the last edition. And it's about an optimization on the link state routing protocols. So, in mesh networks, we have to find a trade-off between the reactivity of the network and the noise, the overhead, generated by the routing protocol. Because if we want a reactive network, we'll have an higher overhead, because we have a lot of messages that are being generated by the routers. And on the other hand, if we want if we don't want this overhead, we will have a not reactive network. So using POP routing, we use the centrality metric to configure on each node a specific timer for this reactivity to optimize it. In this GSOC, we implemented the POP routing using Prince on OLSRD. Last year, we implemented it with OONF, the second version of OLSRD. And we implemented also a plugin for OLSRD to update these timers, and we tested everything using NEPA test. So, in a mesh network, as many of you know, we have dynamic routing protocols that are basically softwares that runs on each router of the network and exchanges information about their neighbors. There are two families of these routing protocols: link state and distance vector. The main difference is that in link state, every node of the network knows the full topology of the network, and in distance vector protocols, the nodes just know the distance vector, so where they have to send the packets to reach a destination and how far is it. We have some example of routing protocols, of link state routing protocols like OSPF and OLSR, and distance vector protocols like RIP and Babel. The reactivity of the network depends, as I said before, on the period or the rhythm on which these routers exchange this information about their neighbors. And the length of this period can be configured by the users, usually in the configuration file. If we fasten the emission rhythm, we increase the reactivity, as I said before, but we also increase the message sent. So we are going to find the optimal trade-off for each node in the network. This is the definition of business centrality. Is a metric that measures how many shortest path passes from a network on the node, and it's usually it goes between 0 and 1. So in a line network, the central node will have the centrality 1, and the leaf will have a centrality really lower. So the more important a node is in the network, the higher the centrality will be. It's implemented by the Brandes algorithm that doesn't have a really good and optimal complexity. It's quadratic with the logarithm, but it's the best we have. And usually it works with this kind of network that are not so huge. Usually not more than 100 nodes, some hundreds of nodes. Pop routings calculate the best timer for each node in the network. And this timer is usually proportional to the centrality of the node. So the more central a node is, the faster the emission will be. So for a central node, we have an example later. And it will be not proportional, but the inverse of proportional on the degree. And yeah, these are the formulas, but I don't wouldn't get into. Prince has been developed last year using C languages. We have two components, the Prince core that is abstracted by the routing protocol, and it has a specific protocol that interact with the routing protocol. So this year we implemented this part here for OLSRD and also this part here. And so Prince can be reused for many other link state protocol like OSPF or I don't know. It works by asking the topology to the routing protocol, usually using NetJSON, and then it calculates the centrality on the network and calculates the timers and send them back to the routing protocol. The plugin behaves as an abstraction layer. And there are just two functions exposed to the core that are get topology and push timer. And for some routing protocol like OLSRD, another plugin is needed because they cannot receive these timers. Instead, for OO and F, there is already everything built in, so we didn't have to develop it. This is the interaction scheme. It's quite simple. It asks the topology. This is the specific command for OLSRD using the JSON info plugin. And then it calculates the centrality, use these two centralities to calculate the timer and push them back using this custom command that we made with this plugin. We tested it using NEPA test. That is a simulator for a community network. It creates a Linux container in which these softwares run, in this case Prince and OLSRD, and then connects them using a specified NetJSON graph. So we can build whatever topology we want. We use these three topology for some trivial tests. A is a line, B is a grid, and C is a ring to find out easily some bug that otherwise we wouldn't find so easily. And yeah, the work is easy. The graph gets generated using these models and with fixed size like 6, 9, 12, up to 36. Then we set up the network, we execute the experiment, and we collect the measurements to analyze them later. We measured these values, so the errors between the centrality calculated using Prince and as a reference, we use the NetworkX library for Python, and the error on the calculation of the timer's value. And to validate the working of the plugin for OLSRD, we measured the delta t, so the emission timer after we modified these values. These are just some graphics. And we see that the error is always under the 0.1%, so we can assume it's calculating the right centrality, and even for the timers it's even smaller, so yeah, it works. This is the graph that shows that this is a normal OLSRD running. Usually it has the hello timer set at 2 seconds with some variation, some hysteresis, and after 30-40 seconds we send the command to set it at 5, and it works as expected. This was the topology used, trivial topology. And yeah. Conclusion, we have released the version 4 of Prince that supports both OLSRD and OONF. And Prince has been released and packetized for OpenWRT up to the release, up to the version 0.3, and it, you can use it. You can just install it typing opkg install prince. And yeah, this is the last test we did with a more complex network. These are like chains of 15 nodes on each side, and we were failing. We were killing this node to see if the network were behaving better or not using prints. And yeah, this is the result. The result. The green one, the blue one is the time using pop routing, and the black one using normal OLSRD. We can see that using pop routing, the network converge 5 seconds earlier than without using it. And so yeah, we can assume it works. And we hope you will use it or try to use it in your community network. So yeah, there are some future developments going on. We would like to support the distance vector protocols like Batman. But unfortunately, without having the topology information inside the node, it's difficult to calculate the centrality. And we would like to improve it using the edge between a centrality, that is the centrality on each link instead of the node. And with this, we could implement it using OSPF, that is widely used, and it's a link state. So well, thank you. If you have any questions, how time do we have?
Okay, obviously not. We have a question.
Do you consider making a pull request to the official OLSR people? That is in as a plugin that's included in the future.
We didn't include the software inside the OLSR because it's a separate daemon. Okay. But the plugin for OLSR is there is a pull request open.
Okay.
We just have to figure it out some bugs, and it will be in the mainstream. A feed. So, next one?
Yep, next one.
Huh?
You coming? It's.
Are you doing it? CRPC?
I think I
don't know where the presentation is.
Oh. Yeah. Perfect. Hallo, ich bin. Ist das geht? Ich bin Paul, ich bin relativ neu in der ganzen Freifunk-Szene. Ich halte den Vortrag mal auf Deutsch. Ich hoffe, das ist okay. Zufällig weiß ich, meine Eltern gucken zu über den Stream, damit die alles verstehen. Ganz einfaches Deutsch. Ich habe mit LibreMesh zusammengearbeitet und wir haben uns darüber Gedanken gemacht, wie wir es vereinfachen können, für alle User den Sys-Upgrade-Prozess zu machen. In letzter Zeit gab es ja viele neue Releases und da jedes Mal irgendwie komplex irgendwelche Images hochzuladen und die überhaupt auch erstmal zu finden. Das wollten wir ein bisschen optimieren. Zu dem Vortrag. Erstmal zur aktuellen Situation, wie das gerade abläuft, dann eine Lösungsidee. Da habe ich einfach eine kleine Videoaufnahme gemacht. Dann zur Umsetzung, wie das Ganze funktioniert mit Server, Workern und wie der Client umgesetzt ist. Das Ganze hat eine allgemeine API, die ihr vielleicht nutzen könnt, wollt in der Zukunft. Die wird dann auch ganz einfach kurz vorgestellt. Dann eher eine Frage an euch, was ihr zu der Security denkt oder beziehungsweise was ihr davon haltet, wie sicher das ganze System ist. Da würde ich gerne von euch später was hören. Und dann eine kleine Idee für, wie die API genutzt werden könnte. Da habe ich so einen Online-Image-Builder gebaut. Gehe ich aber gleich nochmal mehr drauf ein. Also aktuell, wenn man jetzt sein Gerät updaten möchte, ist irgendwie nicht ganz so einfach. Ich habe das jetzt mal nachgestellt, wie ich das bei anderen Leuten gesehen habe, die das probiert haben. Das ist irgendwie nicht ganz so intuitiv, dachten wir zumindest. Kommt man teilweise nicht ja, ganz mit, wenn man nicht zufällig genau über sein Gerät Bescheid weiß. Es gibt ziemlich viele Informationen, aber die eigentliche Info, die man vielleicht sucht, ist eher so ein bisschen noch verborgen. Genau, und da muss man das Webinterface öffnen und da irgendwelche Sachen öffnen. Genau, also aktuelle Situation relativ kompliziert. Man muss erstmal rumsuchen. So richtig kompliziert wird es dann, wenn man anfängt, eigene Images zu haben. Vielleicht habe ich meinen Eltern OpenVPN installiert, damit ich irgendwie denen mal lokalen Support geben kann. Wenn die jetzt ihren Router fleißig updaten mit der aktuellen Variante, dann habe ich leider irgendwie keinen Zugriff mehr. Die Packages verschwinden. Dann müssen die erstmal Imagebilder aufsetzen und überhaupt sich eine Linux-VM installieren. War irgendwie nicht so ideal. Jetzt kurz Video, wie ich mir das vorgestellt habe und wie es jetzt auch am Ende des Google Summer of Codes implementiert ist. Das ist eine Lucy-App. Oben wird der Update-Server eingetragen, auf den ich gleich noch mehr eingehe. Ich hoffe, das hat geladen. Ja, genau, ein Klick auf Search Upgrades. Das ist eigentlich alles hoffentlich selbsterklärend. Genau, aktuell ist installiert die aktuelle stabile Version. Es wird jetzt auf dem Snapshot geupgradet. Das kann man einstellen. Hier sieht man jetzt die ganzen Updates, welche Pakete werden upgedatet, welche neue Release wird installiert. Genau, die Firmware wird jetzt individuell requested. Ich habe ja spezielle Pakete möglicherweise installiert. Zufällig war die Firmware jetzt hier schon gecached. Da gehe ich gleich auch noch drauf ein. Wird dann hier angezeigt, leider ein bisschen abgeschnitten. Genau. Und jetzt geht's los. Ja, man kann es nicht ganz erkennen, aber genau, jetzt passiert es, wie vielleicht bekannt von Stock-Firmwares von Fritzbox oder ähnlichen. Das Ding startet einfach neu. Jetzt wird das neustartende Router-Ding gepinkt. Und es dauert jetzt einen kleinen Moment. Und gleich wird dann der Lead-Snapshot installiert sein. Die Umsetzung dabei ist einfach mit JavaScript gelöst. Ich habe versucht, auf Lucy möglichst weit zu verzichten, weil ja eines schönen Tages Lucy NG rauskommt, was alles mit JavaScript lösen wird. Okay, man kann jetzt leider nicht skippen in diesem Video. Genau, irgendwann funktioniert es dann. Ein Reload des Webinterfaces. Und der Snapshot ist installiert. Nach einem Login sieht man dann, dass die gleichen Pakete, die vorher installiert waren, auch noch erhalten bleiben. Also das Sys-Upgrade ist weiterhin installiert. Es wurde nicht einfach nur das Image runtergeladen. Also das Stock-Image. Ja, die Umsetzung funktioniert so. Es gibt eine Lucy-App, die benutzt aber, wird eigentlich nur im Client ausgeführt, also im Browser. Deshalb ist auch HTTPS möglich. Und ich benutze XML-HTTP-Request. Das ist ein bisschen veraltet, denke ich, aber ist dafür ein bisschen kompatibler. CGI.io ist jetzt ein neues Paket, was es nur in den Snapshots gibt. Das ist dafür, um Binärdateien auf das Gerät über eine API hochzuladen. Genau, und alles ist in relativ simplem JavaScript implementiert. Das ganze Paket ist, glaube ich, 2 Kilobyte groß. Das ist jetzt kein Framework oder so, was noch zusätzlich benötigt wird. Der Server initialisiert erstmal alle Imagebilder, parst diese ganzen Imagebilder und packt die alle in eine Datenbank. Diese Datenbank wird dann später bei den Image Requests ausgelesen, um halt zu validieren, ob das überhaupt ein möglicher Build-Request ist oder ob da irgendwelche falschen Pakete drin sind, ob vielleicht die Release gar nicht existiert, ob das Device nicht unterstützt wird. Das ist umgesetzt in Python, Flask als zum Routen der Requests und PostgreSQL. Und dann gibt es auch noch Worker. Die Idee ist, damit das Ganze ein bisschen besser skaliert, wenn eines Tages vielleicht mal hunderte Leute gleichzeitig irgendwelche Images requesten, dass man einfach LEDe-VMs in Sekunden hochfahren kann, die sich beim Server registrieren und dann Image-Requests entgegennehmen. Das heißt, vielleicht bei einer Release hat man dann 100 Worker gleichzeitig laufen, kurz eine Woche später nur noch 5 oder so, damit man nicht einen starken Worker die ganze Zeit am Laufen hat, der mehrere Images parallel baut. Das Ganze möglichst skalierbar gebaut. Ja, die API funktioniert mit JSON. Die Clients pollen dann den Server mit einem Hash des Requests und kriegen einen Statuscode, was gerade so passiert, ob der Server gerade überlastet ist, ob der Image-Builder gerade initialisiert ist, ob das Paket falsch ist. Das ist alles im GitHub implementiert, dokumentiert. So ein Image-Request kann dann einfach so aussehen. Alle wichtigen Informationen plus Packages. Und eine Response sieht dann ungefähr so aus. Die URL wird natürlich dann durch die Server-URL ersetzt. Das habe ich hier ein bisschen vereinfacht. Unter Files, das ist vielleicht auch noch interessant, da kann man dann alle produzierten Dateien auslesen, in einem JSON-Format auch wiederum. Das heißt, wenn man da irgendwie, ich zeige es gleich noch mit Chef, also wenn man da noch diese API irgendwie nutzen will, um Tools dafür zu bauen. Die Security davon ist, habe ich mir jetzt so ausgedacht, ich habe nicht so richtig eine Ahnung, ob das wirklich die beste Möglichkeit ist. Der Worker baut diese Images, signiert die Checksum, der Server wiederum signiert den Pubkey des Workers und der Client hat dann den Pubkey vom Server. Das heißt, der Client kann in so einer Kette überprüfen, ob der Worker überhaupt authentifiziert ist, ob das überhaupt ein legitimes Image ist von einem Server, dem er vertraut. Weil, wie ich ja vorher schon meinte, die Server, die Worker sollen skalierbar sein. Das heißt, es gibt ständig andere Worker, ständig andere Signaturschlüssel und es muss irgendwie ja vom Server zentral gemanagt werden. Würde mich mal interessieren, ob da irgendjemand von euch Ideen zu hat, wie man sowas sicher gestalten könnte. Ja, als Beispiel für die API, ich habe Chef gebaut, was jetzt auch speziell für LibreMesh ist. Es wird aber auch einfach Lead bzw. OpenWRT unterstützt, beziehungsweise auch jetzt als Beispiel schon Freifunk Leipzig. Ist einfach ein Online-Interface, relativ simpel. Es lassen sich Distribution, Release, alle möglichen Sachen auswählen. Dann gibt es so ein eine autovervollständigende Suchmaske. Und mit einem Klick auf Create, was jetzt leider abgeschnitten ist, bekomme ich dann die Infos über das Image, es wird automatisch gepasst, was das Factory-Image ist und was das Sysupgrade-Image ist. Und die Hoffnung ist, dass das vielleicht auch nochmal Leuten erleichtert, so eine initiale Installation zu machen. Genau, so viel erstmal dazu. Der Code ist auf GitHub erhältlich natürlich. Ich möchte LibreMesh danken, dass sie so nett waren und mich gewählt haben, dass ich das machen durfte. Und Egon Null auf GitHub hat mir netterweise seinen Server zur Verfügung gestellt. Vielen Dank dafür. Ja, habt ihr irgendwelche Fragen, Ideen? Ja.
Also erstmal, das ist total cool. Wir überlegen das auch in Weimar zu nutzen. Und mir ist wegen der Sicherheit, da habe ich nur bei GitHub mal geschaut, da kann ich dir leider auch nicht jetzt sagen, was richtig ist, aber ich habe mich gewundert, das nutzt dieses U-Sign von LEDE sozusagen. Und dein Problem ist jetzt, diese Vertrauenskette herzustellen, dass die, eigentlich normalerweise hat man ja eine Instanz auf dem Server, die das sozusagen überprüft. Und du möchtest das gerne die Worker noch einbinden, sozusagen. Da, ich habe auch keine gute Idee, aber da könnte man, habt ihr so eine Krypto-Professur in Leipzig oder so, die man da mal fragen könnte vielleicht? Weil die haben da meistens eine gute Idee, was man da machen könnte eventuell. Das wäre so mein Vorschlag, wenn sonst keiner Bescheid weiß. Ich kann auch mal in Weimar die Leute fragen, vielleicht haben die auch eine Idee. Ansonsten ist mir noch für die Worker, wäre Docker vielleicht ideal. Dass man das gleich, das ist ja letztlich, so eine Docker-File sind auch nur 2-3 Zeilen, genau. Aber cooles Projekt auf jeden Fall. Wir versuchen es einzubauen und dann werde ich dich bestimmt nochmal nerven, wenn das okay ist. Und dann, genau, okay.
Okay, scheinbar keine weiteren Fragen. Dann kommen wir zu Arne.
Deutsch oder Englisch? Hört man mich? Bin ich laut? Hallo, hallo? Ja, klingt so. Spricht hier jeder Deutsch? Does everybody in this room speak German or? You don't speak German. Okay, that's reason enough to do this in English. About me, I'm Arne. This was my second GSOC for Freifunk and the last one, because you're only allowed to do it twice. And I have implemented a system, a very basic system, which in the future should be able to provide centralized management of wireless access points in a larger deployment. So if you're running a bigger network, you would have a centralized controller. So you could realize a sort of split MAC approach to split the 802.11 stack between the controller and the access points. And I've done that using an Onos SDN controller. This is my only slide. I'm going to treat this like a poster talk, so don't be afraid, because this looks very confusing in the beginning. Basically, what you can see here is at the top, we have our control plane, which is a centralized server. And at the bottom, you have the setup of one node in your network. So this would be your lead, your OpenWRT access point, which is connected to your controller through one control channel, which is important for my work, and then another one. I'm going to get to that one later. So if you want to manage an access point from a central controller, the controller has to know a lot of things about these access points, which is why I had to write this. I'm calling this the agent. This uses a lot of things in the lead ecosystem to learn about the system it's running on, about the available interfaces and the capabilities of the device, and then sends all that to the controller, so the controller can then create an abstraction of the network nodes and then present the entire network in an abstracted way upwards towards applications. And then you can have applications which only talk to the controller, and then the controller forwards these commands or queries to the relevant agents in the system to realize the central management. So for example, you could have a load balancing application, for example, that just queries the controller for the load on the individual nodes and looks if there is a client, for example, which has a weak link or could use a better one, or there's an overloaded node, and then issue commands towards the controller, which will then forward them to the nodes to redistribute clients, for example. Just a very simple and obvious benefit of having a centralized view of your network. So this is the central link to the controller. It's this agent. It's written in C, and it mainly uses the IPC bus on lead systems, which is called UBUS, to, for example, talk to the network interface daemon to learn about the interfaces, and then talk to the host APDs, which are running your access points on the node, to realize things like removing clients or querying the capabilities of individual clients and so on. To the right-hand side, this daemon was actually last year's GSOC project, which I did. It started as a sort of link between the network interface daemon and Open vSwitch, which is a software-defined networking soft switch implementation, which is, I think, by now part of the standard Linux system. It's been extended for this work so that the agent which I wrote can learn about Open vSwitch instances on the same system, and then relay that information to the controller, so the controller knows which Open vSwitch is running together on the same system as the agent it's talking to. So to create a link between these two boxes logically. Yeah, so actually I don't know if I've mentioned this, but I've based all this on my bachelor's thesis, and I think 2/3 of the work of the bachelor's thesis just went into this very small part, the control channel, because the Onos controller is a very modular, very nicely structured Java implementation. And here, as I've said, I'm using C. So since I want to talk a common protocol, and there's this nice tool by Floodlight called Loxygen, which generates libraries in C and Java, among others, for OpenFlow protocol extensions. I wanted to use that, and then I was sitting there for 3 months making the two things compatible, because Onos is using a fork and took a lot of time. But in the end, I managed to have a compatible C and Java library, which are then responsible for the communication. As I've said, the control plane is written in Java. Here I had to write a protocol driver, it's called, in Onos, which is talking to my agent. And then I have the core controller logic on top of that, logically, which would create the abstractions from the resources which it learns about from this agent. And you can see that I've circled some things in red. Those are the parts I mainly worked on. So as you can see, there are no real applications as of now. That's because I ran out of time in the end. But there's a REST API exposed by this controller at the top. And there's a Java API, of course, and even a command line interface if you want to fool around with it manually. As of now, the system isn't of much use, but it's intended to be a sort of foundation. So you can create your centralized view of the network. The problem is you can't really do anything with it just yet, because it's lacking applications. But as I've said, a load balancer would be a really nice idea to steer clients towards individual access points, or change the channels of the access points so you're not getting too much interference and so on. So there's a website which I created together with a colleague of mine who also participated in GSOC 2017 for Freifunk, because we worked towards combining our two systems. He wrote a centralized device management server, if you want to call it like that, which provides a centralized configuration tool for lead access points, or no, lead systems as a whole. And using that, you can configure the agent on the lead system to work with my controller, for example, or other things. And this makes bootstrapping really easy. In theory, you could unpack a device. It would auto-discover the server that my colleague wrote. This would then install the configuration, so the software on the device can reach the controller, which I've implemented. And from then on, you have control using the SDW and controller, which I wrote. As I said, this is a website. Go check it out. It has the links to the repositories. It has documentation on how to bootstrap the whole thing. And of course, I've blogged about it during GSOC. So this, for example, is just the final entry, which I posted, I think, in August. Yeah. I'd love to hear from you if you want to use this. If there's, I'm 100% certain that there's going to be problems, but I'd love to hear about them and maybe about suggestions how to use the system in the future. I'm pretty sure it can be beneficial in the end. I know that it's very basic at the moment, but I'm still working on it as part of the research at the university where I'm employed. And yeah, I can only encourage you to use it, try it out, and send me feedback. Thanks a lot. Are there questions?
I think, does it work?
Yep.
Yes, it does. I think ordinarily you don't want to steer clients because you have an installation where you you need to set the access points correctly at the correct places. And the way that we want to go in the future is that the clients decide which access points works best for them. And we don't want to steer them. There are several solutions like that in commercial systems. I know of them, but it's ordinarily not the correct way to do this.
Well, I'm not too experienced with the problems that arise from large deployments, but what I've been told is if you use commercial solutions in the first place, then you have vendor lock-in, of course. This is an open system, so you could use hardware from different vendors. For example, this is just a small point. But what I've been told, I've never tried this, but if you have a deployment which is growing, for example, and you install a new access point which has a slightly stronger signal than your old one, then all the clients in the vicinity will just connect to this one because it's a slightly stronger signal.
We have had such problems before too, and we informed ourselves how people in the USA do this with very large installations. And you really have to take measurements when you do the installation and set the transmission powers accordingly.
Okay. Well, what this system might offer in the future is to do...
Maybe this could do this automatically. That would be very fine, but it's not the correct way to just say, I kicked that client because... devices in the future will decide on which access points is best and which is crowded.
Okay. Let me just add that this system is also intended to be as a sort of foundation for other applications where you would have, for example, virtualized access points running not on the physical APs but further back in the network. And then you could have like seamless handovers between the physical access points by just moving the virtual access point as the client roams. But for that, you would need to have the centralized view of the whole network and the ability to tell an access point to remove a client and move it somewhere else. So, as I said, it's not really the kill-all solution as of now, but it's intended to be a foundation and based on open software, free software, which is very extensible to realize more complex things in the future. Okay.
Okay. There don't seem to be any more questions. Thank you all for presenting your project here. Another small information, we plan to apply again as Freifunk organization to the Google Summer of Code for next year. And as of now, we are collecting ideas for possible projects we can do next year. So please contact me if you have any ideas and we can add them to our projects page. Thank you.